need more light in this room. I can't play this stupid thing. And I don't want to put all those stupid attachments on just so I can see the screen, which barely even works anyway. Stupid monochrome. Oh, there's got to be a better way to portable game. I died again?
What do you think you're doing, Dad? You're playing a Game Boy in this dark room? Why don't you play the SEGA Game Gear? It has a backlit color screen.
There's an easier way to get color. Get a Game Gear, the full color portable with over 150 games, like the new Echo, Mortal 2, and Sonic Triple Trouble.
Sega! My daughter was right. You definitely want to play in a dark room with a backlit screen, and who doesn't want color? So, basically, this unit came out in 1991 in North America, and had a price tag of about $149 American. Now, what was unique about this was there was already three handhelds on the market to compete with. You had the Game Boy, which was already dominating the market, especially in North America. And then you had the Turbo Express from TurboGrafx, or NEC. And you had the Atari Lynx, which I actually was a proud owner of both. Now, if I go back and I look at it, the Game Gear definitely came out and dethroned them. Absolutely. It knocked over the Turbo Express and the Atari Lynx with no effort at all. And that was because, one, it was a Sega product. Two, price point. You had the Lynx coming out, I think, at about $200. And you had the Turbo Express coming out at $300. But there was a bonus to the Turbo Express, and that was the fact that it was actually a portable TurboGrafx 16. So you could justify spending the money to a point. Now, the other cool thing about this system was, now it had a great price point. It was definitely the better format as far as being wider, easier to hold. It was definitely way more comfortable to hold than a Game Gear. So you see here the Game Gear. So it was up to you as a user, what you liked more. And of course, I was definitely more for the Game Gear. It was a way more comfortable product to hold. Moving on, the problems this product was faced with. Why did it not dominate the market? It was technically the more advanced system. It was so far advanced, it was an upgraded master system. This thing had everything going for it, but one huge problem. Nintendo. So the problems this unit was faced with was, one, Nintendo already had, with their archaic graphic system being a monochrome, not backlit screen, which to me is just absolutely terrible, but it still managed to dominate. Now, why was that? Well, it was clear. They had third-party game support that the Game Gear was lacking. Now, with Sega behind it, of course, you had your Shining Forces and so on and so forth coming out on this with your Sonic the Hedgehogs and so on, making this still a great console to buy. But it just wasn't enough. At the time when people were going to jump on that bandwagon and get that third-party support they were looking for, it was just too late. By 1997, the unit was deemed as canceled. And it wasn't that it wasn't a success. It sold over 10 million, almost 11 million units. Unfortunately, Nintendo actually sold about 100 million units. So as you can see, night and day, Wipeout City on this one. So of course, round on that goes straight to Nintendo's Game Boy, whether you like it or not. I don't seem to like it, but that's just the way it goes. The Game Gear was definitely the superior product. Unfortunately, didn't have the steam needed to dethrone the king. Guys, it was plagued for its time for numerous reasons. One, it had a big battery hog issue, which its competitors had. So the TurboGrafx and the Atari Lynx were just battery hogs. Yes, Sega came out with a better game library. They came out very fast and hardcore. They did great job on marketing in the very beginning, and then they just did this with their marketing, which of course killed the steam. Now, you would get about 3 to 5 hours battery life on these units. Of course, today is a great time to collect them because there's all kinds of crazy mods for them. So for example, there's a backlit LED mod, so you can actually have a better battery life, up to about 12 plus hours, which I'm about to do on one real soon, and I'll show you guys that in a video. There's also an LED or LCD mod screen, so you can do a McWill mod and have a better screen, so you don't have that faded look or that pixelated look. It just looks absolutely modern and beautiful. And doing so also gives you another LED mod. Therefore, you got better battery life and an amazing product. Just waiting to get my hands on one of those screens so I can do that for you guys as well. Collecting for it in 2019 and beyond is actually a great idea. One, games are usually found at yard sales or pawn stores or flea markets, relatively cheap. Now, there are some selected titles, of course, that are extremely expensive. And that would be, for example, your Mega Man that took me forever to get. And I got it in a great trade when I was doing a game show. And I can never thank someone enough for that. So that was awesome. So guys, let me know what you think in the comments below. Game Gear versus Game Boy. We all know, really, even if you're a diehard Game Boy fan, the true winner, hardware and technology, was definitely on the Sega side. They just didn't have the steam needed to dethrone them. So guys, thank you for watching. And now a message from my little sponsors.
Hey, thanks for watching The Last Game Hunter. Tell us in the comments, what do you think is better, Sega Game Gear or Game Boy? Game over!